As software engineers, we all know how to create prototypes and write code and write documents and design things and even make a big project that ships. It might even be something that ships on its own as a commercial project. A more typical task, especially for engineers in big tech, is to be working on a project that involves many, many people that's far too large for a single person or even a dozen people to do. So how do you go about doing that? What's the process you follow? Hi, I'm John Miller, the deliberate engineer. I've been programming for 40 years, and I spent 30 years working at big tech or FAANG companies like Microsoft, Google, Amazon, Oracle, and many other companies as well, producing commercial software and shipping it. I've been a software engineer, a principal software engineer, software engineering manager. I've been a de facto program manager, a product manager. I've even been a tester, a test manager, and a manager of test managers. So I've done a lot of different roles and seen the software production and release process in big tech from a variety of different perspectives. Some of the products I worked on, including Windows, where I worked on three different networking components: Windows load balancing services, also known as network load balancing, IP security, universal plug and play, peer-to-peer services. I worked on memory management and module management, some multimedia technologies, both wave audio and something called MCI, the Media Control Interface. Later on at Microsoft, I worked in Microsoft Research, shipping V1s of things, including a graphics program called AutoCollage, and shipping a prototype of the Avalanche peer-to-peer content distribution engine, which we renamed Microsoft Secure Content Distribution when we used it to ship Visual Studio. I also worked on Flight Simulator 2002, and I guess technically Combat Flight Simulator. Later on, I worked at Amazon on Kindle backend services and the Kindle client, as well as Fire backend services. At Oracle, I was helping to develop security and identity services. At Google, I worked on display ads optimization, which is taking a look at the ads infrastructure and figuring out ways to improve targeting of ads so that they are less annoying to people and ideally give better results for the people who are placing those ads. Over all these years, I've seen a lot of things go right and a lot of things go wrong. I've seen teams that operate very smoothly that have terrific results. I've seen teams that are in trouble for a variety of reasons, sometimes process, sometimes people, sometimes external influences. All of these things are related to trying to get a project to ship correctly. So why am I telling you this? Well, it's a long-winded way of saying I've got an awful lot of battle scars from shipping things. But I've also got a lot of ideas about things that can help you to be more likely to be more successful, especially when you're working on a big project in big tech. This is the introductory video in my series, Building Big Software. It's aimed at people who are working in big tech or who want to work in big tech, working on projects that could have dozens or hundreds or thousands of people working on them. It's a collection of practices and of habits that will help you to be more likely to succeed and help the project to be more likely to succeed. By the time you watch the whole series, you should have a much better understanding of what it takes to ship commercial software and understand things that, if you're just going through them without any background, might seem ridiculous to you. Help you understand that, oh, it actually has a purpose and it actually does some good. Now, you don't actually have to be in big tech to watch these videos. A lot of it will make sense even for a layman. It is possible that some of the terminology will go over your head, but for the most part, it'll all make sense. So I'd encourage you to at least take a look and watch the videos that sound interesting to you to get more of an idea about how software is built. For the rest of this video, I'm going to break down at a very high level what's going to be in the rest of the series so that you can get an idea of what titles to look for and what to watch. I think of making a big product as really being in two phases. The first phase is pre-design, where you decide what you're going to build and then you specify a rough outline of it. And then the second one is the actual design, where you get a team that's growing to work on that project, to flesh it out, to deliver it. And both of these are equally important. Of course, a product never makes it to the design stage without first going through the pre-design and the green lighting. The first thing you need to do as part of pre-design is identify an opportunity to make a new product. Now, this could be taking a look and you're in a company whose competitor has just done something interesting and you realize your company needs a response for it. Or maybe you see an opportunity out in the marketplace that nobody is working in a particular space and you can get some sort of a unique advantage for your company. Those are two good examples of where you would identify the opportunity. That's just the very beginning, where now you start gathering data about the opportunity. For example, you'll take a look and get an idea of how big the market is. You'll try and understand whether your company has specific strengths that can be applied to make a good offering here. You'll try to figure out the balance of what it will take to produce versus what revenue it can bring in and other ways that it could benefit the company. One example of this would be in the 90s when Java proposed a technology called Genie, which was a way of getting devices to talk to each other, a lot of what we'd call Internet of Things today. Their proposal had to do with being able to discover these devices, authenticate to them, connect to them and exchange data, control them, and so on. They understood that they had a chance to leverage their platform-independent runtime into something that could run on even smaller devices and enable something that hadn't been there before. Their motivation for this would be simple. First of all, they would get to control a new emerging market. Second of all, they would get to make lots and lots of money off of it, or so they hoped. Once you have a rough idea of what you want to build, then the next step is to start taking a look and gathering requirements for it. These won't necessarily be the final requirements, but they'll be high-level guidance for what should be built and why. One of the strongest recommendations for this is make sure that you make a note of why something is a requirement. For example, if you say, well, we want to be able to service a million connections, you might want to say something like, this is an arbitrary requirement. It's based on being three orders of magnitude better than our next competitor. The reason you want this context is as you try and scope the project and come up with the minimum viable product, this will let you decide which of these requirements can be safely discarded. Like this one is more of an aspirational requirement. It'd be safe to get rid of if it was going to be a real headache. On the other hand, having security might be an absolute requirement that you can't get rid of. Finally, you want to produce a vision and a vision document that describe the overall project, the motivation for it, some of the various requirements, and what information you have so far about how hard it's going to be, how it will fit into the long-term goals of the company. You want to identify that minimum viable product, but you also want to talk about a roadmap that would be subsequent versions that you can move forward and what you might hope to accomplish. What this does is shows anybody who sees the vision that you've really thought about the space, you have a reasonable story that they can go and double check as to why the company should get into it, and you won't go down a dead end. You already have ideas of how things will improve after that first version gets released. So all these things are critically important. In addition to the vision, you want to have a solid elevator pitch. An elevator pitch is sort of a 30-second vision statement. It's something that you could bump into somebody at the elevator and say, hey, John, what are you working on these days? And you could say, why, I'm blah, 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 and blah, blah, because blah. And you want anybody, whether it's a developer who might be interested in joining your team or a vice president who's in a position to green light you in the future, you want them to walk away saying, huh, you know, that's an interesting idea and that totally makes sense, and be able to describe it to somebody else. So your elevator pitch, it has to be compelling, has to be simple enough to remember even if you're not an expert in that domain, and it needs to sort of encompass what the soul of the project is going to be. You have to have a vision written down that you can propagate and get greenlit on. You need to have this elevator pitch to support it. So after you have those two things, then typically you'd go through a series of meetings with executive management, and they would green light the project. Or they would say, no, we're just not interested. We have more important things the company needs to work on. Assuming the project gets greenlit, the next stage is design and execution, which is the bulk of the person hours that are going to be spent on the project. The first step in design is to have sort of a lead architect who's going to be responsible for deciding what all the different components are, how they fit together, how it integrates with other products at the company, and so on. They don't dig down into great details on these things. Instead, they're really just outlining what the different blocks are, which will probably correspond with what teams will need to be created or retasked to work on the project. Sometimes these things are just too big for a single architect to lay out. In that case, they would pick a team of trusted architects and software engineers to help them come up with a vision. They would still oversee the whole thing and make sure it's on track, but this lets them spread out and have, say, a dozen people working on the overall vision and fleshing things out rather than just themselves. At the end of the architecture discussions, you should wind up with an architecture doc. Again, this doesn't provide many details about how things are going to work. It just outlines what the system's going to do, what the different pieces are. It might have some technology choices like, oh, we're probably going to leverage this library from this company rather than making our own. Or it could just say TBD. It's really up to the project how significant the architecture needs to be. The architectures that I've seen for big projects, say 50-person, 100-person projects in the past, have been on the order of anywhere from 30 to 100 pages of document. When you're talking about something bigger, like all of Windows, that architecture could be thousands of pages, and it would really only go down to the upper component layer, and then there would have to be separate architectures for each of those components, because the block is still too big to get away without having an architecture. Anyways, this is the first step, creating an architecture. After the architecture is done, then it's time for the software engineering teams that are actually going to be implementing that architecture to dig down into a design. This is a layer of abstraction above actual implementation, but it's more specific than the architecture might be. A design would typically include things like, we believe that we're going to use this algorithm and this algorithm. Here's a description of how this is going to work. You know, here's the different components. If there's an external API, it might also include that external API or the shape of this overall component and how it relates to other things out there. It would have its own set of requirements and its own specification of what it's going to deliver. For example, a design document for some sort of a distributed store, it wouldn't necessarily tell you the byte formats of what it's storing, but it would say things like, we're going to use a quintuple replicated block system. There's going to be an index server, and then the blocks will be stored in a variety of distributed servers. Each of the blocks will have at least two replicas and no more than five replicas. They'll be tracked at this frequency. They'll do this. We want them stored on this type of media for resiliency. Here's a strategy for making sure that we can recover from disaster and things like that. They won't necessarily go down to the level of explaining how the code will be written, but by reading the design, you have a good idea of how things will fit together. And as a programmer, you'd be able to start working on implementation. Speaking of implementation, there's an optional next step, depending on the project and depending on the company, called an implementation spec. The design spec is still relatively abstract. It doesn't talk about things like the class structure, header files, or the private versus public members of things. It doesn't talk about how subclassing is going to be done. All that stuff does belong in an implementation spec if you decide to make it. Design will typically talk about external observable interfaces. Implementation spec will often go into details about the submodules that will never be exposed to the outside world, but which are very important for being able to figure out how the different pieces will work together to get the job done. If you have a formal test team, that test team might also put together a test specification that describes how they're going to make sure the design is adhered to, and if there's an implementation spec, how that implementation is going to be double-checked. It'll talk about what they consider invariants, it'll talk about the level at which they're going to verify things and any tools that they need to make. Now the test spec, a lot depends on the type of testing you have in the team. If you don't really have a test team per component, if instead the developers are expected to do that work, then they'll be talking mostly about integration testing, how to make sure the overall architecture and overall design works, not just these individual components. There's a lot of other work that goes into the design and implementation as well. For example, having a security model, having a threat model for what's going to happen there, being able to make sure you'll be able to deploy the software, that you'll be able to maintain and upgrade the software, disaster recovery, and so on. All these things typically have written artifacts associated with them that have a lot of engineering time behind them. That, in a nutshell, is most of the written artifacts that you'll have to produce to be able to create and coordinate a large-scale project. There's still lots of other things that go into having that software project be successful and be delivered correctly to everyone, but that's a bit outside of the scope of what I'm intending to talk about in this series. If you're interested, I invite you to watch the next video I have coming up, or any of the other ones that make sense to you. Thank you for making it this far, and keep on pushing forward. Hi, this is John. Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please think about subscribing so you get notified of my future videos. Also, if you are interested, you might want to check out the video I have linked here. Thanks, and keep on pushing forward.